Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. This is Monday, 6th July, and I'm Fehreen Kazmi, your English language teacher, here with you. Let's start our today's task of week 3, unit number 2, with the grammar portion. And today we are going to learn about exercise number 2, of unit 2, how to make noun from the words and collective noun, and use of hyphens, and primary and secondary stress, and use of must and mustn't, and then reading comprehensions, question answer, B section, page number 20. And this is all about the exercise of the unit. And here is the description about the grammar portion and part A to be done on textbook, while part B to be done in textbook, while part D to be done in the notebook of the page number 21 and 22, while oral page number 23 and use of hyphen would be done just for understanding and reading comprehension of question 1 and 2 would be done on the notebook. By learning the lecture today, students will be able to find more collective word, fill in the blanks with the correct collective noun, and then understanding of use and must and use of must and mustn't, and students will be able to answer the reading comprehensions questions of the Chinese New Year. So students, our first topic is about making noun from the words and then collective nouns. So we understand that many verbs in English language can easily convert it into nouns with additions of suffixes. You can also change certain verbs to noun depending on the context of the sentence. So we understand that the many verbs of English language can easily convert it into a noun, right, by adding suffixes at the end and by using different techniques. So let's understand how we can add suffixes. Add ance or ence to verbs. If we add ance and ence to the verbs, then it becomes the noun. A wide variety of verbs can be changed to nouns with the addition of suffixes ance or ence. For example, the verb appear became appearance. If we use ance at the appear, then it become appearance and it become a noun. So sorry, the verb resist become same resistance. So resistance and appearance are the noun. So we say that by adding ance or enc to the verbs is about the making noun. Second one is add ment to verbs. If we put the suffix ment to the verbs, then it also become a noun, like assign, enjoy, appoint and appointment. And assign is a verb. If we put ment at the end of the assignment as a suffix, then assignment is a noun. Then enjoy, then enjoyment. Ment at the end, it will become a noun. So this is it. Third one is add tion or sion. So we are observing that this is all about adding suffixes. If we put anc, enc, and then if we put ment to verb, and then tion or sion. So decides, describe, information, decision. Decide is a word, verb, decide, and then decision, then describe, then description. Shun, sion, sion, tion will change the situation of verb into noun. So the sentence meaning and the structure is also changed. So here is about the collective noun. There is a collective noun. It tell the students collective noun refer that name which represent a collection of things, person taken together or spoken for as one a whole. Army, jury, family, nation, crowd and herd, etc. So we understand that the group of a particular noun is called a collective noun, like army, jury, family, nation, etc. Next small topic was about the usage of hyphen. There are some rules written over here that about the hyphen. So we understand that hyphens are used to divide words to the end of the line when the word cannot on the remainder of the line. There are six rules to follow. First one is divide the word between syllables. It means that one syllable word are never divided. So it is telling us that if we are having a word at the end of the line with the having two syllables, so we will put one syllable at the end, and second syllable can be held at the last at the second line. It can be divided with the small line of hyphen, and then it will be okay. But if there is a one syllable word, that it cannot be changed. If you will put or you will cut the word into two by using hyphen, that will be not okay and not admissible from the person. Second one, the hyphen goes on the end of the first line. So first line can be contain the hyphen word hyphen. And third one is prefixes and suffixes make natural division. So if you are using two prefixes and suffixes, then there is no need to put the hyphen over there, because these are the natural. And next one, do not divide proper nouns adjective. So you don't need to put the hyphen over there, like park, istan is a two syllable, that will be same. So you will not put, if you will put the hyphen over there, that will be not okay and not right and not admissible from the checker. So fifth one is there should be at least two letters plus the hyphen on the first line and three letters on the second. Again, there is a thing that is telling us that two letters plus the hyphen on the first line and three letters on the second. If you are using hyphen at every line, so you will put the two letters plus the hyphen at the first line and then second. Supposedly, as you are observing that sup is the right, and then he put the hyphen, and posedly is written separately. So this is acceptable, while supposed and ly is not acceptable. And six is divide hyphenated words using hyphen already in the word. Mother, M-O-T-H, moth, and E-R is in law is written over here. That is incorrect. And mother, in-law is acceptable. Mother separate and in and law must be hyphened. Right, so this is these are the six rules for using hyphen in written expression, and this is also important to learn. There is no written work over here for hyphen, so you will just do the collective noun work on your notebook, and noun making noun is also your book work. So this is all for your understanding. You can also check the video on Sabak Foundation, sabak.pk. You can also go for your better learning, for getting assist. Although I have explained it very clearly before you, but if you have some problem, then you can also go for Sabak Foundation video page. And then there is primary and secondary stress. Stress is about the spoken thing. So it is also about with the mark. Primary mark and the secondary marks. Primary marks is the basic and major, and secondary is the second portion. It comes on the second portion of the syllable, and primary stress in the first syllable. So first syllable stress is called the primary syllable, and the second stress will be called the secondary syllable, right? And syllables are the words that produced with the single chest pulse. Is called the syllable. ठीक है, हम जो भी word produce करते हैं, जैसा कि है supposedly. अब जैसे यहाँ पर word है supposedly, right? तो हम कहते हैं supposedly. So, dear student, you see that these are called the primary and secondary stress, and let's move to understanding more further about the thing that the loudest syllable in the word when it is spoken. For example, when you say the word fantastic, the primary stress on the middle syllable tas, okay? Fantastic. So there are three syllables, right? This word fantastic is produced with the three syllables. Three single chest pulse occurs when the word is produced. Fantastic. Okay? Then tas is coming in the middle syllable, and the primary stress will occur on the tas. So your part A should be done on the textbook. While read explanation about the use of hyphen on page 23 and 24. For further information, you can go for again for your Sabak foundation. Let's move to use of must and mustn't. So, dear student, let me tell you that that must and mustn't are the modal verb, the verb. Type of verb that is particularly used for the particular purpose is called the modal verb, that is used for specific targeted things to enhance the value of the worker is called the modal verb, right? Must and mustn't. Must is for the strong obligation, while mustn't is for the strongest prohibition. So all cleaning must be finished before New Year's Day. It is for, we are observing that it is for the strong obligation. It must be done. It is your duty that you have to done. If you will not do, you will not be accepted by the society people or the particular place. Because everybody is doing this, you have to do it. So it is must. And mustn't, as you are observing, that it is for negativity, but it is for the strong prohibition. It is not in the rule of the particular society, so you mustn't going to do this. Mother says you mustn't play the matches. Aapko iske saath nahi khelna hai, matches ke saath mat khele. This is not right to play with the matches. Theek hai? So this is it. It is telling us about the strong prohibition. And it is a part of modal verb, and you see and you better understand where you have to put the must and where you don't need to put the mustn't, or you where you need to put the mustn't, right? So let's move to our fourth topic, in fact, that is about reading comprehension or question answer. The question is about 1, 2, 3 and 4 from your chapter 2. Why does Chinese New Year start? When does Chinese New Year start? Chinese New Year start with the lunar phases, about the moon phases, almost from the 21st January to 21st Feb. So you will write it with 30 to 40 words explaining by your own self. And then question number 2, why do Chinese family do thorough cleaning on their houses before New Year Day? So what the reason why they clean their houses before the New Year's Day? So the reason behind the cleaning and washing all the thing and wearing the new clothes is that they welcome the New Year, and they go through and they throw out and they ward off the bad luck and bad feelings from their houses. So they clean the house and welcome the New Year in a very good way for the whole year. So they do the cleaning. Next question is, which color is not allowed and which color is encouraged in Chinese New Year and why? What the reason behind it? Red color is acceptable for wearing, and it is considered good and encouraged good for wearing red color because it is for welcoming and it is for good luck, while black color is not acceptable. It is considered as a bad and misfortune. Next one is about question 4. Why do decorations on doors and windows symbolize? What do decorations on the doors and windows are again the symbolization for the welcoming of New Year and for the happiness, and with the word of foo, that is for the welcoming the new year. And this is all from our today's task, and hope you understand all the lecture. It's time to say goodbye to you, and Allah Hafiz from me.